forms of urban agriculture in Cuba are varied, and they're situated in unique locations with specialized conditions. So none of these forms that I'm about to describe are the same in every single location, but they serve as a sort of categorization of the different ways in which urban agriculture is realized in the Cuban urban environment. And these photos are drawn from our Farming Cuba book, and more elaboration on them could be found there if you're interested. So the first kind of urban design that urban agriculture takes on in Cuba is that of the microgarden. And so this picture here is a picture of a microgarden. And you can see that entails things like space hijacking, something we might call in the US guerrilla gardening, where you plant things at the little strips of land outside your building. You might have cultivated window beds, and you might have some small places on your patio where you can plant small plants of various kinds. The next kind of urban agriculture would be a yard. So this would be something that is more like a patio environment, again, embedded within an urban environment, where reclaimed containers, in this case maybe tires or planters, become the farm, and in some cases smaller beds are able to be grown, generally a little bit more area available to grow in, and occasionally sometimes there's even livestock in these environments. So there's a chicken in this picture. And in this picture it also has some support for the other aspects of agriculture that are necessary, for example a compost bin or a compost pile in this case. This yard is connected to a private household and then becomes a source of food and profit in some cases for this household. The next level as we scale up would be vacant lots. So this would be a lot within an urban environment, which is possibly one of the plots of land that the state gave over in this process of usufruct so that farmers could be assigned that plot as theirs. They would farm it and generate profit from it, but it could only be used for farming. So here's an example of one that has a few trees, some trellises, and in this case, some livestock. So the next size up would be something that is an intensively cultivated garden. So this, you can see, takes up more like a block within a city environment. It's not just a lot next to a building. And this environment might have its own market for selling its produce, its own farm stand. It might have a variety of different kinds of plantings. It might even be large enough that it can support an orchard, have more of a pen for animals, as well as a variety of places where tools can be stored and composting can take place at a larger scale. The next category is something called a self-provisioning garden. And a self-provisioning garden looks a lot like a yard garden or maybe an empty lot garden, except what's happened here is that it's been associated with some kind of an organization that benefits from the produce grown there. So often this would be used for schools or retirement homes, community homes of various kinds, where a garden, a yard, a small urban farm will be created, and then the school benefits from the produce associated with that farm. The next version would be a high-intensity urban garden. This is an urban garden which supports, high expertise, larger than our lot gardening. This would be an environment that maybe uses support from outside of the urban environment. For example, bringing in organic material, bringing in soil from support areas located farther away. More extensive retail space and more area for growing in general. Then the next level up would be actual state enterprises. So these are full-on farms that are in much larger plots of land, typically on the perimeter of the urban environment, rather than having enough land for this level of agriculture to occur within the within the city proper. This kind of a agriculture environment is notable because it tends to have more irrigation, more support for irrigation than the smaller farms do, which rely either on hand irrigation or just irrigation from rain. So the last kind of farm is just a full-on agricultural farm that's located well outside the city limits and has all the support that you would expect of a modern farming environment. So now the thing about all of these that is important for being successful, the reason why the kind of support that Cuban government had for these urban agricultural models and these different categories was that they provided ways to get agricultural support through state-run composting enterprises, ways of getting soil and organic material into the urban environment so that these planters could have something to grow the plants in. A variety of seed storehouses and seed greenhouses were created so that the people who wanted to farm could have access to the organic, you know, the seeds and the seedlings from which to grow these plants. Support from markets in which people who didn't have space for their own market could bring their produce to trade, to barter, to sell once they had grown them in their own environment if they weren't large enough to have their own market. And then finally, someplace to take the green waste and then to convert it into the composting as well. There's also a couple categories of urban agriculture that are specifically about animal husbandry. Right. So here's an example of what one of these urban gardens looks like. And while urban agriculture in 2012 makes up a substantial portion of Cuba's food consumption needs, it's not without some concerns. For example, growing food in urban contexts often exposes the food itself and the food system to toxins that are in the ground and in the atmosphere because it can be a very polluted environment. Cubans have responded to this by using raised bed gardening, as seen in the picture here. Raised bed gardening requires that soil and organic material be brought in from other locations in Cuba, and the border of these raised beds might be leftover pieces of roofing material, construction material, other discarded industrial materials, which pose their own toxicity problems by themselves without considering the environment in which they're in. And so, as well, to the degree that livestock is being farmed in urban contexts, issues of disease and sanitation are exposed as the animals have to be managed and the waste of the animals and the food products of the animals have to be managed. Urban agriculture also has to contend with the proximity to many more people who are possibly may steal the produce. They may steal the equipment, they may vandalize or otherwise interfere with the farming in ways that wouldn't occur if the farm was out of the way of the urban environment. So this is sort of an interesting study because in the context of the food collapse, Cuba changed the way that they were doing urban agriculture. Well, unfortunately, the story isn't over. Post-2005, after the point at which Cuba had sort of made up a lot of lost ground during this starvation period, Cuba continued and continues to struggle with its goal of food security, especially in response now to natural disasters, as opposed to political storms. Hurricanes and droughts hit Cuba particularly hard in 2005 and subsequently caused Cuba to lose ground on some of its agricultural progress in terms of its stability and security for food distribution. It still relies on imports to feed its people, and it struggles to keep food prices under control, even within its socialist model. And as a result, like many other countries, many of its citizens have poor eating habits and related sicknesses, including diabetes. So this is, of course, about global infrastructure, global disruption, and information technology. Well, where is the information technology in the story? Well, it's interesting because in this collapse, basically there wasn't any strong information technology. There certainly wasn't any strong information technology that was brought to bear on this response to food collapse. And at the time it was occurring, the ideal of mobile computing, the promise of mobile computing remained just in the work of science fiction and futurists. So a different question we might ask is, how would the response to the food collapse, the food infrastructure collapse story, have been different if there had been widespread information technology? Is there a way that urban agriculture could have been done today, perhaps in the United States, that would have taken advantage of the affordances of smartphones and ubiquitous networking that we currently have in our existing environment? Throughout the story of Cuba's food collapse, issues of prices, logistics, information, and education, particularly for the farmers, teaching them how to farm, were at the forefront. And these are all forms of data and communication and knowledge transfer that IT tools are pretty well positioned to address, but weren't available to address them in the case of Cuba, making their response all the more impressive. How could urban agriculture have benefited from local communities sharing tips and tricks? How could seed distributions, food distributions, how could marketing and planning have been aided by computers? How could they have been aided by computers that knew where they were and perhaps knew where the other computers were in real time? So from farming Cuba, in summary, necessity pushed Cuba to adopt a largely agroecological approach to food production, meaning the rejection of green revolution. And urban agriculture became a primary means of feeding urban dwellers. The food collapse that happened in 1989 not only affected agricultural production in the countryside, but had a concomitant effect of limiting transportation into cities because fossil fuels weren't as available as well. So agricultural support facilities became inoperable, and energy scarcity limited the capacity of agricultural and food processing plants. Even consumers had difficulty accessing goods from established vendors. They didn't have access to the fuels for transportation, less money, etc. So a combination of both social innovation and political will has allowed for the development of urban agriculture, the latter appearing to be the single key factor in guaranteeing the program's longevity. Cuba's urban farming program was triggered by the need to reduce the oversized food importation bill that made Cuba a net importer, that made them dependent on other sections of the economy externally, the global economy, financially and materially. This network of gardens and farms continued to grow. And in 2009, the creation of a new economic program to specifically address peri-urban agriculture, agriculture on the ring of the city, demonstrated or created substantial increase in urban farmland within Cuba. Design is likely to have a different role in cities worldwide. So the aesthetic architectural urban planning design. And depending on the evolution of the urban food system towards its new equilibrium, that will need to shift in order to ensure food security. Furthermore, this design thinking will develop in parallel with changes in the urbanization process. Design has the opportunity to become the primary tool for integrating the food-related and spatial demands of a new urban scenario currently owning its nascent state. That from Farming Cuba. So, thank you very much. Cuba is a very interesting story of a nation responding to food collapse, food infrastructure collapse, remaining networked within a global geopolitical environment, and to some degree responding in a way that required them to become a sustainable healthy food environment. Thank you very much.